Africa, where they're asking questions and they gave 30 seconds. Just looking at Africa broadly. I've been on about 40.
About 40? That's big.
Yeah, minimum. Minimum. Yeah.
So what can you share?
I have about 4 every day. Sorry?
What can you share?
You can open an unlimited demo account. I think the first thing that is, I noticed that some industries, you know, especially in the healthcare space, are booming. You know, the IT data companies are booming. Your Zooms of this world, so on, Cisco. They are booming. You know, social media is booming. The time where everybody has been on social media. Everybody is on social media. Everybody.
Okay.
Facebook, Twitter. So they're getting a lot of footprints on social media. I've also noticed that food companies, companies that are selling food for sustenance, food has been a big factor. A lot of people have cozied up with food. Because they can't do any much else. They can't work. Some people cannot work from home. But I've also noticed that a lot of people have suffered, especially the poor, the migrants. So there's been a lot of activism that I've done around raising money that actually is ongoing in various communities. Today I was even talking about, they were telling me about some Zimbabweans in somewhere in Richards Bay or somewhere. So I've seen that there's been a lot of pain for those who, especially in the informal sector, the unemployed migrants. And so there's been some move in that direction. There's a lot of people who are doing a lot of good things. But I also see that there has to be a different way that we must connect as a community. And we can no longer leave it to the usual supporting a business that people that own that business are not supporting you. So we have to become more conscientized and maybe less of a consumer. Maybe we need to go back to eating just one staple food 3 times a day if it's packed, and that's it. And the reason why I say that is because for those who don't have savings, this is them dangerously. For those who don't have savings, you know, they lose their job. They lose their job, what are they going to do? They have a mortgage, they lose their job. But this can increase the depression, this increased depression on many levels, and also it's increased violence. There's a lot of people who have never had to be in this kind of situation, their families and all that, locked up all the time. They can't go anywhere, especially before the level 4. So there's been a lot of things that I spotted. But all in all, we have to thank God that in South Africa, the numbers are not too high, and that in Africa, so far, with our poor healthcare, we haven't had thousands and thousands of people dying, even though they say we're going to hit a wave and so on. I'm worried about the fact that they're relaxing those things without people also, people breaching the rules. Social gathering or social distancing, whatever you want to call it. I'm worried about that because the cases in South Africa are growing. There's some new problem areas, but so far I think that Africa's not been, you know, the epicenter. No country in Africa yet has had 500 deaths a day, 1,000 deaths, you know, even the whole continent, we're still in about under 4,000. I think we're about 3,000 something.
Okay.
Yes.
So that's a mouthful.
Yes, I have to give you the broad spectrum so that you know that at least I've been involved. I can't do 40 and be talking like somebody who did one webinar.
Yeah, it's a good update on what's going on. And we find out an enemy that has no face. So
they say the face is China.
That's what they can say, but Well,
I know what you mean. It's not a physical enemy.
Yeah.
It's an unseen enemy. But some people are saying this is the source the blame must go to, because there's no problem without a reason. Whether it's a natural disaster, whether it's a virus, there must be a reason for something to happen. Be natural, unexplained, but naturally, a fault somewhere, whether it's an earthquake, this is St. Andreas fault. So this one started from Wuhan, and at the end of the day, you know, the people who are dying, and the world's economy has been torpedoed. We're not saying it was deliberate, but sometimes when you make a mistake, there must be some kind of, you know, in insurance, they say that, I've forgotten the word, there must be some kind of liability. You know, mm-hmm. There must be some kind of, when there's a mistake, if as a result of a mistake, you hit my car, that's why people take out insurance. So countries where people have come in from some country, but the source is this, there should be some kind of, this is where the underwriters have to come up and say, look, yes, we have to limit the claims, or perhaps if at the end of the day, 500,000 people are wiped out in the first phase, what would be the net loss to those families? Because a lot of the people that are dying are not young people, the people who are still in their productive stages. So how can we, because there must be some kind of compensation, particularly to those who are the most vulnerable in society who have lost. You know, it's up to the lawyers anyway. It's like aircraft. I mean, but this one, people were sitting in their houses or in their countries. Somebody came in, an index case, and then boom, 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 and then where we are. I don't know. I'm not sure how these things work.
Oh, that's a good start. At least,
if China was a poor country, then obviously there's nothing we could do. But China has a lot of influence on a global scale. They sit on the Security Council, second largest GDP. They have a lot of projects in a lot of countries. They manufacture a lot of goods. If they were able to say they would take out 1% of our GDP, it should be about about $140 billion. Yeah, about $140 billion. Spread that out to the countries that suffered the greatest damage. Even if it's going to end up being for each loss of life, that they say, okay, we will subsidize. They look at the cost of spent, what Paris has spent. Mm-hmm. Give them maybe $10 billion here and there. I think people will know better. It's like the TB Joshua case. You remember TB Joshua?
Mm-hmm.
Remember that he killed 85 South Africans.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't follow the laws and so on, and then he came and did a charm offensive and he helped those families here and there. I think it's a psychological thing. It's not going to take you with the pay. But if I were to advise the Chinese, and I'll tell them not to make noise about it, rather than rushing with masks, which is good, to Africa with Jack Ma, that's all well and good. The families that have died, because I'm hearing something somewhere that they said the U.S. should also do something for HIV. I know HIV started in the U.S. I saw an headline, but it didn't mean much. Yeah, I just thought it was bizarre. But I don't know if you heard about it, that the Chinese are saying the U.S. should also pay damages for HIV.
Okay, no, I'd not caught of that one.
Okay, I will send the headline to you. It's something that is not hidden. I saw it. It may have popped up in one of these smaller, because it didn't go viral.
Okay.
Well, on your side, are you back at work? Because I know that you work anyway.
Yeah, no, we are just observing this the the invisible stranger that is causing a lot of problems.
It is very scary. And, you know, what I was saying to somebody, I said, the statement made by the finance minister was very worrying for me, because when you target the pandemic, we were trying to deal with palliatives for the poor. Then the minister comes with his own story about, you know, foreign nationals and restaurants.
What did he say? I didn't hear.
Okay. He said that when he came here in 1990, that most restaurants were staffed with South Africans, and maybe there were a few Malawians there and there, but today there's hardly any South Africans working in the restaurant business, and that those who want to claim the COVID relief for their businesses will have to show proof that they employ more South Africans than foreign nationals. And I wrote an episode after that I can prepare to share with you. And it also brings Mugabe into the picture. And I don't mention the CIO. I talk about Mugabe. The soft, clear diplomacy approach that did not work. Because ALSI may have helped the power. They don't ruffle each other's feathers. The ordinary Zimbabwean was escaping at 100 miles an hour to an uncertain future, just with the clothes on their back. And so today, Zimbabwe, a great nation, wants the breadbasket of Southern Africa, with great company, for excitement. Collected the land, and they gave it to themselves, and the other people that they gave it to, they cannot produce as much, because commercial farming is different from subsistence farming. So, yes, you have the political and so-called economic power, but there's been no progress in 40 years. I can't say. Oh, this company is a Zimbabwean company, you know, across Africa. They'll see it. They couldn't try it, but it didn't work, because it's not easy to do business in Africa. You need a lot of conditions to be right, and so you can't compare Dangote with a Stripe, because Dangote gets all the support from the succeeding governments, rather than Zimbabwe, where they're chasing the rich people. They're pushing the rich people away. They're not friends of business. Sorry?
Yeah, that's one way of observing. But if you look at Africa today and put yourself in it, and say, we started Africa Heritage Society.
Yes.
Yet you have wanted one person to define what it should be. Is there any logic that would make you vacate taking responsibility for not building a community around the values that you learned?
You're right. I think all of us have been found wanting. I know that I didn't do enough to play my own part, because at the end of the day, when you say Africa Heritage Society, it's not somebody's, it's like when they say African Union. Nobody owns the African Union. Yes, they have big men, presidents, and chairman, and so on, but they don't own the African Union. It's not their father's house. So if one is serious, one has to get stuck in. And yes, we can criticize the old men as much as we want, but they're not going to give us space unless we're inside the room with them. So I think you're right in that sense, that we probably
Not we. Not we. I.
Okay.
That.
Somebody was that I owe it to you when you used to tell me that, you know, when I have my ideas and we're talking, I say it's all in his head. So I said I owe it to you that I then started to do my media activity, writing for magazines regularly, going on radio, to the point where I even got on to television and all of these things. Even though it was short because there was some issue. But yes, I agree with you. I have no defense.
So if you have no defense, imagine it, you with at the Last Supper, and Jesus said, I'm leaving you to find yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not coming back. What I have exposed you to is enough as a story to be told. Go and tell the story and multiply.
Absolutely. Bring forth and multiply.
But we have failed to, as individuals, to have conversations around the themes that you learned, even from Africa heritage. What is it that inspired the name itself? And who is an African? And what is it that stopped anyone associating in its name, in the name of the actors in it?
Nothing stops us at all. Nothing stops me.
So is there a white force that prevented anyone from saying, I am that African and I'm supposed to live my memory, part of it, in the name of this idea called heritage, that we all share the same heritage, that is African, that is not Nigerian, that is what we have built it to be, that when we joined the African National Congress, it was to fulfill that idea of a Congress of African people.
Mm-hmm.
Yet you were there and you are not telling the story of what you know, what you knew, and what are the facts that would then manifest themselves in the governor. That Zimbabweans, Nigerians come here as eternal parasites. They are not part of the dialogue on what kind of South Africa should be. And when
you, parasites.
Yeah, that you come here, you are not even here. Imagine a person leaves Nigeria, arrives in South Africa, but still is in Nigeria in the mind. The doctor that you were talking about, America.
Yes.
You say you have traveled so far, but you have not left. Can you imagine?
That is dangerous.
And your Professor Lumumba, he sees an African as a person. He's talking to an Africa that doesn't exist. They are individuals. There is a civilization. Professor Lumumba talk about the clash of civilization. That even the people in Europe and the people who ran away from Europe and arrived at distant shores with nothing, no balance sheet, but arrived with an idea that where I go, where I arrive, that's where my spirit is. That if I go to Libya today and try to encourage those people from Niger, from Nigeria, to say, go back where you came from. He looks at me and he says, do you know me? And I say, you are an African. You must go back to Africa, to your place of origin. He says, my friend, look at my back, look at my scars. I have traveled this far to run away from where you want to take me. How cruel can you be to deflate a balloon that has left a place that Trump calls?
Like the young man called Giannis Antetokounmpo,
yeah,
the NBA,
yeah,
the basketball star,
yeah,
is Greek origin, African Greek origin, but he's a superstar in America.
Yeah,
he can't even relate. He can't relate to Africa.
No, it's not just that. That for you to be an African, you must understand that Africa is not a person.
Yeah. Oops.
Africa is the geography. So if Africa is the geography and you are part of the geography, then and you are in majority. But after 20 years of Africa heritage, you have nothing to show for it. Then you must go to the mirror yourself and look at yourself in the mirror and say, how far I have come, yet I have not left where I started. How many people have gone to England without leaving Africa? But their bodies are in England. And they blame the people they left behind. Why there's no electricity, yet they ran away from darkness.
Wow.
But they can't share that darkness.
Are you on your show?
Why do you ask?
Your show has what do they call it? Unlimited lifespan.
Yeah,
then you are putting more radio hours than those who started radio long before you even started.
No, I'm just sharing because I'm so angry that people like you are not storytellers. They are argument platforms where we argue without telling the story as it is.
Mr. M, I wanted to even distract you a bit. Somebody sent me the stats, you know, the audience stats.
Yeah.
On radio. So they sent me. So I must compliment AG73. I must commend them. But I wanted to share with you. Are you there, sir?
Yeah, I'm listening.
I wanted to share with you so that at least you can see, because I know that most of them, they're streamed live. So I wanted to share the stats with you. Would you be interested in seeing your stats?
No, no, I'm saying is the stats are, you know what stats are? Is history.
I know.
But right now, we are building content for 1,000 years from now. They'll hear your voice without seeing you. And they'll say, okay, why is Ade Tunje talking about stats, not talking about things that he has experienced in his life? Instead of having a conversation with Ade Tunje, he will be looking for a pathway that nobody has experienced on. Imagine somebody, I lead you where I've not been. Every day I live in life. Every day I live in life is a day.
What I wanted to share with you is that I'm impressed at the, you know, it's YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. I think Twitter, yeah, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube.
No, no, but I'm saying, I'm trying to discourage from talking about stats, not talking about sharing. If you were to, let's say it was my obituary, and you were asked, what would you say about me? Because there are people who see me today.
I'll start with legendary. Legendary.
Okay, why would you call me a legend?
A legend. You raise, you made people think. Even when they want to sleep, you wake them up. You make their brain pump the volume. If you were a white man, you would be president in your country. There will be no contest. They don't appreciate intellectuals like you. They're a legend. I remember your book, When Minds Meet. You have done it all. The only thing you haven't done now is to hand over.
No, I'm saying is the first thing when you say somebody is a legend, then you're already undermining the whole constitutional basis of life.
Constitutional basis of life by calling you a legend.
That's right.
You're a legend. You know,
no, the constitution. The constitution is built around the equality of men.
Yes, but you have raised the bar.
No, that's what you are choosing, because you are blinding yourself to one person.
No, I'm not. I've been here for a long time, and I've met a lot of people, and you know we have done that on many levels, inside, on the roof, outdoors. You are a legend.
No, no.
It's not legend in terms of money, it's just your prowess, your intellectual ability, your application, implementing, you know, motivating, expanding the theater of knowledge. I mean, I remember knowledge, execution, and capital. How can I forget? In the early days, when my father came to give a lecture at the, you remember the African Heritage Property, is it not the Property Association, but there was a platform there. I mean, there was so much happening. Yeah, there was so much going on. Long before the advent, long before we moved to 325 Rivonia Boulevard, I remember also the series of lectures from Dalimpofu to Ashiru, ambassador for Nigeria. I remember Ali Mazuri. I remember, I mean, these are things that you don't, the greatest civilizations, they don't put things like this knowledge, where people sit on a Thursday, even Friday evening, and we listen to deep insights about knowledge, about capital, about execution, how we must get together. We can have our own bank, the new Mitra. Then I was in the old Mitra. Then you came up with the concept of the new Mitra. And, you know, there was also Mutual and Federal at the time. So I'm not even, maybe the word I'm using is flowering. But you are a rock of knowledge. And it's difficult because most Africans, maybe because of our experiences and how we're taught in school, that we want to navigate towards the position of least resistance, shy away from the burden of crafting our own alternatives rather than sticking to what we already see and we can touch. And that is maybe the divergence where most people feel, oh no, this what this guy is talking about is too deep. Why can't he just, you know, why can't he just say something that I can easily understand, like what is the date? So when is next week, Thursday? When is, you know, so I think it is in that sense that an epitaph or do a eulogy, it will be very, very much along those terms, you know, leadership, thought leadership. When there was no, this was before even the Thabo Mbeki African Leadership Institute, Timali, which some people now claim that once they've gone there, they're now the Africa strategy. So I'm really serious that you guided us, and I spent a lot of time coming close to you because I was picking up some serious nuggets about leadership and about action and about implementation. Do it. You know, don't wait for the next guy. Do it. That's why I always tell Wildfire when he tells me about the record that he got, and I ran to get him pepper soup from home base, and I paid for it in winter because I was listening to him as he was going for the record. And I got there until it was not recorded. I say, it was not recorded. Tell me, this thing is not recorded. There's no. I went to get pepper soup for you. In my whole career in radio, nobody brought me any delicacy in winter that will cure the cold that is not tea or coffee. Nobody. And then this man, Guinness Book of Records, now we see it, now we don't. I said, okay, no problem. Maybe you have not taken the food training yet of Mr. So today I'm not forgiving him. I don't believe he should be, he should be angry. And you know, the problem with the man is that he doesn't even, he said, I will do it again. I would. That even made me more angry. Because I know he can't, I know that he can't again. And even if it's going to happen, circumstances can never be the same. Because there was one chap who was with him. And that guy, so I don't know who's going to go through the same thing with him again. And these were early days when the station was brand new, more or less. But anyhow, that's like c'est la vie, as they say.
So if you learn something and the power of structure and order, and you look at the greatest business in the world was started by somebody who disappeared after showing the idea. If you look at Jesus and you look at Prophet Muhammad and you say, what is it that allowed them to think ahead of their time, that they could die? And 2,000 years later, there will be people who follow the person that is dead for 2,000 years. What do we learn about leadership? What do we learn about being a legend? Because he was no legend. He lived his part. paid his dues and paid the ultimate sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
So what do we learn about Africa heritage, about the person? That's why I always say Africa heritage is not about me. It's about you. In your own words, in your own action. That when I'm gone, when I'm not there, what do you say about me in the things that you do? Like your father was there, he is gone. But his words are gone. Somebody would transcribe his words and make sure that his words live after him. But he was just not a speaker. He was a speaker who could speak to the things that he knew about. Things that were revealed in his own life. And things that happened in his own life. He came to speak to us to make an argument. But just speak about his own testament of what life holds, what surprises it has, the people you meet. And somebody here, he says, Mawere, you talk about the Constitution every day. Imagine somebody alive says that. The girls who were abducted ago, are you aware of them? What is he saying that some people may not understand? You stupid. You talk about constitutionalism. It's your own. Yet the Constitution is about all. Do we have a shared understanding of what a constitution is and is not? He then says, so they are not protected by the Constitution. What Constitution can protect girls from evil human beings? Can a Constitution stop murder? Can a Constitution stop crime? Somebody who say, I learned something from Mawere that no Constitution can substitute the human being. What is wrong is wrong. A constitution is just a reminder that we are not animals. We are human beings. We are gifted with the power to reason and the free will. That the moment we interfere with someone else, and we suspend your freedom, even for one day, it's one day too many. I don't have to say that. But the person who has led me over the years say it will be able to summarize that in an eloquent language. That Mawere say never said, a constitution is a substitute for morality. But some people will say, Mawere, you started Africa Heritage. When is the next meeting? I said, what meeting? Said, you used to have meetings. I said, yes. I was just provoking you. And I'm surprised that after 20 years, you've not even convened one of yours.
They're waiting for you.
They're waiting for Jesus to come back. And I'm not Jesus. They're waiting for Mahatma Gandhi to come back. I'm not Martin Luther King. I'm just me. with
you're not Joshua Nkrumah.
I'm not even Joshua Nkrumah. I'm not even Father Christmas. But how many people think that somebody came to me today from Dubai? He's telling me that he wants to pimp me. There's somebody who is looking to do a project. He's looking for money. Can you talk to this guy? I said, so what makes you now? You got my number from somebody. Now you are calling me. Are you a pimp? Said no. So why are you pimping me? Says, I think you will be the right person. No, not even. This guy put money in a new mutual. But I said, my friend, just imagine this 24 hours. And I got 50 phone calls. And everyone is asking me the same thing you are asking me. How am I going to accommodate 50 phone calls? And after I attend to the 50 phone calls, what kind of person would I be? Would I still be a human being or a little Jesus?
Africa.
Just human nature. That we are human beings, we expect the neighbor to know what we don't know. So I told him, if you are organized and structured, doesn't matter whether I am alive or dead, it means the show will carry on. Because you have decided to do something. You don't have to wait for somebody. You don't have to wait for me. Remember when they said, Mawe, can you be first? They were using our offices and said, it's an ANC branch meeting. Somebody came to me and said, why don't you join? I said, why not? Let me join so that I become part of the problem. So that those people who come here and say, no, ANC belongs to other people, and it's called African National Congress. Let us be the Congress in the ANC. And what do they do? Professors, educated people, they say Mawere raises a national question. If we allow Mawere to rise above a branch, what would stop him from being a president? As if I'd apply to be a president of anything. You may have been there, you may not have been there. While people who used to come and celebrate the togetherness of Africans would then see the differences in Africans.
When it suits them.
No, it always suits somebody to see the differences. Who are there to tell the story that, yes, Malema, we were there. We were part of the same organization, and then what happened? And you saw it happen. You witnessed it. But some people will talk about things that they don't know. And people they never met. And they make a story out of something they don't know. And what we learn from Jesus is that his disciples just told the story as they understood it. They never created something they didn't know.
The gospel according to the apostles.
Yeah?
What is that noise, Mr. Hare? What is the noise in your background?
Well, it's just the noise of some unsolicited messages that keep on coming.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's so annoying.
Okay.
Yeah, then they almost cut your balls. Remember the 500,000 fraud story. Yeah, you go and Google. You find my name, and for some reason, ANC was actually involved in an alleged fraud. Can you imagine? Involving the lotto. And this happened, and somebody will create a story and tell the newspaper something that doesn't exist. And then attitude is silent. And yet, I'm saying is today people are talking about xenophobia. People are saying after COVID, people must go back where they come from because they are coming here to take something away from us. And Mawere ran away from Zimbabwe, you are told. Mawere, you have known me all these years. And if I was a fugitive, you would have known.
Absolutely.
But nobody will say, not in my name. How can you call Mawere a fugitive when I know his house and I have been there? But how many of these people are the people that Jesus described that they would deny you? They would rather talk about something else than what they know. Yet what they know is what makes people come together to say, yes, if it can happen to Mawere, it can happen to me tomorrow.
Absolutely.
And then you now have references.
It happened to me.
That's right. So
I told me my membership was only 2 months old, and at that time my membership was over a year. They told my wife that she's not welcome.
So where is that story told? That somebody goes to a club of members. If I go to church today, somebody tells me you don't belong, you are not welcome. What kind of church is
that? That's no longer a church, that's a cult.
No, it's not even a cult. It's not even in the Constitution. Because imagine you give up your time to be a member of something, and that something is exclusionary. Then you say you fought so hard to build bridges. Having won that battle, you create walls. What kind of battle is that? That is, these great minds thinking that we have an idea called a Congress. African people, one nation at a time. Then you have arrived. Then you ask Dr. Arikana to say, you're talking about Africa. Let me tell you, my sister, this is the Africa I know and the Africa you ran away from. And you say we must be united as Africans. But we can't even build one institution where my wife is told that you don't belong because we are fixing a Mawere problem. As if Mawere invited himself to be a chairman. It will appear as if I left Zimbabwe with a view to becoming a member of the ANC for the purpose of defrauding somebody.
It's a strange situation.
But no,
very strange.
But nobody's telling that story. So when you speak to Wildfire, say, what is the story to be told? And all these people die with these untold stories. Graveyard. And there's nobody to tell the story. How do we build a Congress of African people when Africans themselves cannot be in one Congress? And you say, yeah, so that's the story that we are not telling. So the radio platform, so that stories can be told. And you never know, 100 years from now, your voice will be missing. And nobody will tell it like you have known it. How many of us come to on social media live shows to make argument that all South Africans they hate foreigners? Yet we know the individuals, and all we can talk is about the individuals, like the Bible as individuals. It doesn't have a blanket story. No. It talks of individuals. It talks of miracles. It talks of witnesses. It talks of a last supper individual. And that story never dies. It doesn't change. Because it's not an argument. It just records that on this day I was a member, my wife was a member, and all of a sudden my right to belong was taken away. Not by God, but by human beings, and you know their names.
We're out.
So you are out, and you acquiesce to being out. And you know what that means. Because when you acquiesce, even Mandela, he was imprisoned, but he asked to speak. Imagine he didn't speak at the Rivonia trial.
Yeah.
What would have...
But I still look. Maybe I have to a letter, but I can't find it. I didn't just acquiesce. I wrote them a stinker. It's just I didn't go public. But I wrote them a stinker. I told them I gave them a piece of my mind. I wrote it. And Dlamini Zuma was AU chair at the time. This was 2011, going to 2012, somewhere there, before Mangaung. So I wrote. I didn't just keep quiet. It's just I didn't go public.
No, I'm saying, you know why the Bible was written as a public document, not a private document?
I'm listening, sir.
Yeah. So please learn from what Jesus said. Please testify that you knew me. And tell the story as you have known it. Nobody will tell the story better than you.
Absolutely.
But if you go on a stage...
I think my wife's one hurts me more than mine. Because look, I brought her in. I chose to join them. In fact, when I tried to join Brad Fisher, and Sipho Majombozi was giving me the runaround and so on. And then when I came back from one of my trips and I saw that you were very much involved, I jumped in with one lady, I've forgotten that. And then all of a sudden, these people are telling my wife that she's not welcome. And I'm thinking, but we are a branch. We're supposed to built. Everybody should be. It's like a church, like you said. I mean, a political party and a church, there's no difference. People from all persuasions are supposed to come, and we're supposed to support it based on the party's principles and values and so on. And now they're saying, you are not a member. You are this, you are that. Oh, it's just terrible. Very unfortunate.
So that's the story that is not being told.
Yeah. Yeah. And we were supporting, you know, even then I remember I used to do wine tasting for years. I come and stand there, standing for hours. People are drinking the wine, you know, we sponsor the stuff. They never have money. It was all effort put in to build the branch. Some people just come and they torpedo everything for their own selfish reasons.
No, but I'm saying it's not the self, because you are an example. You know what Mandela said, that if he was asked to choose anyone to step in his shoes, to have stepped into his shoes, to spend all those years in Robben Island, you know what you would have said? That God chose the right person, that he was the right person. Because if he had not endured, then what cause would have been worth fighting for?
That's true. That's true.
So other people
still proud of you, you know. Life, sometimes these things have to happen for us to see the next level.
No, I'm saying they happen for a reason, but imagine those who know the truth are quiet.
That's the thing, you know, even during narcissism, a lot of people didn't say much and they knew the atrocities that
happened. That's right.
Like what happened was, I posted it on Facebook. I have a video of that lady crying in the hospital. There's another lady that was wearing black. I saw the picture on Zimbo Live TV, but I couldn't pick it up. But I want to start tomorrow because I think that for women to be grabbed and raped, and if nothing happens to the perpetrator...
No, now you are... I'm now into argument. I'm saying talk... No, I'm saying you are now into can
one thing then to another. And the government was very, very calm about crushing them, or when they crush them, they don't think about the fallout of the crushing. They just go asleep. So what is happening in Zimbabwe worries me.
You are now into argument. I'm saying
there's no sanction. Nobody gets arrested. Nobody gets to prison. And this is just on our doorstep here.
No. I'm saying you are now into arguments.
That can be raised in 21st century.
No, what?
For no reason.
What would you? I'm saying you are now into arguments. We can't finish arguments.
Sorry?
You know, Jesus. Sorry? I'm saying you are now into arguments. When you start an argument, you are talking about things that you have no personal knowledge of.
No, I just saw it.
I see, let me talk about things that I know.
Okay.
And then talk about things you know about your wife, because in the final analysis, what you say is what will change the people of Zimbabwe, that I was there when it was happening, but I chose not to say something, and I exported my voice to Adi Tunje and Mawere so that on social media they can talk about me without knowing me. So let us allow Jesus to die so that we can tell the story. And those who lived, they tell the story anyway. So we don't need Mandela to come back, Mugabe to come back, but we can tell the story about things we know. Yet sometimes we want to get into arguments about things we don't know. I don't have the facts that I need to be able to be a judge of any situation. But what I do know is where there's rule of law, where is constitutionalism, things like this will never happen, even to your wife. Because people would know that everybody has got a right to decide what they need to do. And I must respect that choice of the individual. And I'll be slow to limit that choice, because limiting limits my own choices. That's what informed Africa Heritage. That we must be able to talk about things that we know, not about things we don't know others. Because we have a lot of stories that we are not talking about, we are not telling. There's nothing that will substitute your mind, your memory. Yet we are closing our memories so that we can tell stories as if we are alive when Jesus was alive, when Prophet Muhammad was alive, we were alive. You say, but why didn't you take a selfie with him if you saw him? Yet there are more than 1 billion believers. And they all remember the story of Prophet Muhammad. But no one has ever seen his picture. So I'm just to provoke you, because I thought if I don't record it, then it will be me and you again. If we look at the amount of hours we have spent, where is that content? It's not there. And we take for granted life. Your father is gone. He can't come back to tell the story. Yeah.
How many minutes have we been speaking?
1 hour. And imagine 1 hour, 1 hour plus some minutes, and somebody says, oh, repeat that topic again. Come back again. It's like we're just talking and no script. But to provoke you, Adi Tunji, when you call me, please record, because one day I may not be there.
You know, let me make you laugh, Sam. I'm gonna send you an interview I did with Ambassador Luke, the former ambassador of Ghana, South Africa to the USA.
Okay.
He said to me, time and time again, he said, Adi, hey, Adi Tunji, where now? We need to record these things that we're doing. We need to even get Tabo big. Because I started that NDTV on YouTube 2017. So he was very happy. He said, we need to write a book. We need to record all these things, because we sit in his house for hours, talk about things, deep stuff. And the guy was drinking his wine and going deep stuff, deep, real issues. You know, he's very intelligent guy. Lawyer, everything, intelligence, ANC, ambassador, DEFO, everything. Botswana, Lusaka, Romania, Ceausescu, he had done it all. So, unfortunately for me, two things saved me. I went to interview him. It wasn't a very And I went with him to his school in Soweto, where I interviewed him briefly. Can you imagine if I didn't even get those two interviews of this guy? It would have been a disaster, a total disaster. But this guy, our friendship was about about 10 years, 11 years, 12 years maybe, because he died on July 9 last year. Dr. P, the guy told me, he warned me, Tunji, let's record. I said, ah, Dr. P, don't worry, we'll do it, you know. Today, if I had not brought in those two things in, it should have been the worst nightmare for me.
No, again, like now, you are talking about somebody, not about your reflections on an issue.
No. I haven't given you, I'm talking about, look, the conversation we were having is in the context of.
No, I'm not talking about conversation, you know, like the storytelling I'm talking about.
Yes.
It's just to record what you know, that I was at a dinner with Kaunda. I was there.
Mm-hmm.
Ali Mazrui is gone, but I was there.
Yes, even Ashiru is gone.
That's right. Ashiru is gone, and there are people with. Yeah, your father
is gone.
No, I'm saying is that these are real things that happened in my life.
Yes.
And the quest was to identify this African heritage.
Yes.
And be able to get this identity. Who is an African?
Yes.
So in this conversation, we sought to hear from others.
Mm-hmm.
So that we are all talking as one.
Mm.
Let me just check. Hello, Prince.
Hey, my brother.
How are you?
I am extraordinary. I'm sitting here with a great lady who has a vision that, you know, Israel is challenged by immigrants from Sudan and from Eritrea particularly, and I wanted you to work with me on a vision that we got to resettle them. Which country would you say would be amenable to us investing $50 to $100 million to develop operation? What country would you recommend?
I think you can look at Zimbabwe, Mozambique, Tanzania, Zambia. Those are countries where English is spoken. There may be some Portuguese there. And there, West Africa is one with $100 million. Dollars, there are 100 million solutions in Africa.
Because, okay.
Because each million in Africa means a lot.
Now, what I want to do, since you know Zimbabwe, I wanted to come and see you in South Africa with her, and we lay out a strategy together.
No problem. You know, we are soldiers, and when the prince calls, we have to rise up.
Thank you, my beloved brother.
So we are there to do what is required, and you can count on us.
One of the things I want you to do is to tell her about our radio station of 1873, so that she will understand what it is that we are doing in broadcasting.
Okay, no problem. Hello?
Yes, hello.
How are you?
I'm well, thank you. I'm Christina. How are you?
My name is Mutuma. I am a friend of the prince, so I call myself FOP.
I love
So we set up a network, and so that we can connect the dots and convert connections into communities. So when we find ourselves in communities, it means we can be able to have structure and order and get our voices heard.
Yes.
And the radio then becomes that vehicle to provide people like you to just download your experiences, your insights, your ideas, your knowledge on things that you have lived through, so that when we build this Bible of the living, then we have better tools than those who lived with Jesus. We can convert conversations into provocations so that others may act because they have heard it. Others may be inspired to know somebody. And others may be ignited to think differently about a problem. So we created this platform and called it 1873, so that we can celebrate the power of one mind, indivisible, and that human beings are human beings. We don't buy gifts of knowledge, but we are born with the power to reason and the power of free will. So if I'm willing to learn, I'll learn. If I'm not willing to learn, I won't learn. And radio is one such powerful bridge, so that those who are divided by distance can be united in voice.
And this is all over South Africa?
South Africa, but because of the digital age, we like to believe that we are borderless. And right now, we are already in America and you are in Africa. So we don't have to fly. And what COVID has done,
yes,
is what it has provoked us to look beyond borders and to rediscover what humanity is, that we are not divided. We are united if we choose to. So that's what we speak every day, banging on Africa's future. What kind of future do we want? And the future is written in our stories. And you know what George Washington said?
What's that?
He said, "I walk on untrodden ground." And every decision I may make and every action I may take is a precedent on its own. That nobody taught me to be a president. So if you want the best president, look in your mirror, you see one. So we are tired of looking up to others when we are waiting for ourselves.
Amen. Amen to that.
So that's the radio, unless you have any question on that.
No, I was wondering where it goes. So you say it's in South Africa, but because of the digital, it can basic reporterless.
Yeah, it's an internet radio, so we can have a conversation with you and find the best country, because my mind does not have countries in it. It's just a small mind. But work together, we'll find a country. The people who left Europe, they never knew what Africa had. They were like George Washington. They took the next step and said, let's go and discover what Africa is. And guess what? They are called colonizers. And so we are here, you are there, and Africa is open for business.
Amen. Amen.
So when you come to Africa, then you see us in flesh, but otherwise we are already in flesh.
What I want to do, I want you to give her a little bit about your background so that she'll know who she's speaking to. Give her a little bit about your experience, Mutumbu.
Okay, born in Zimbabwe, educated in Zimbabwe, Swaziland, the United Kingdom, and America.
Wow.
And I worked in banking, finance, and joined the World Bank as a young professional in 1988. Then when South Africa changed 1994-5, I left to come to be part of this project in South Africa to build this kind of Africa. It's very elusive. So I resigned and then came here, started a company called Africa Resources Limited, in the belief that as Africans, we ought to be able to stake our claim on the opportunities that are abundant in Africa. So I used that company as a vehicle to acquire some assets in the UK, with subsidiaries in Zimbabwe. Then in 2004, I was a beneficiary of a law that was only created for me to take all my business assets by law. That law is 16 years old today.
Wow.
And but I moved to South Africa, became a South African citizen, and I'm still a person who is active in business, but partly it was just to share some of the experiences and what can happen. You may invest in Africa, then 10 years later they say you are an American. Get the hell out of here. And unless we build an Africa that we share these experiences, you may discover that what makes a good country today may make it a bad country tomorrow.
Wow.
And so that's the experience in business. Then we started an association in 2003. Called the Africa Heritage Society, just as a platform to celebrate this common but misunderstood heritage. Who are we as a people? Where do we fit in into the universal human chain? And what we can do with structure and order, and all these businesses that we talk about, or I talk about, just associations of people, not businesses, but people. So most of my best opportunities, I acquired them from people, not from applicants. I never applied to be who I am, but who I am is shaped by other people. So that's the message we want to promote, so that businesses are secure, are safe. Because there are people in Africa who believe that a business can be white, it can be black, it can be capitalist, it can be communist, it can be socialist, but they forget that all we want is to save, that no business exists without a problem to solve. So that's what we are in the business of, problem solving.
Thank you, Luca.
Thank you.
I have one question.
Okay.
Are you familiar at all with the bond industry that they're supposed to be starting in Ghana and offering to like the diaspora to be able to invest in bonds? It was actually something similar that Israel did with the
You see, the problem is where there's no rule of law. That's the biggest challenge. When you talk about America, we may not like the founding fathers for defining blacks as fractions of a human being, but they understood something that is self-evident, that we are all created equal. That if I invest in a bond, I expect a harvest. But I don't want an African harvest. I want a harvest for the money I've put in. So when you look at Africa and look at the centers where constitutionalism, rule of law is there, you will discover that there are few countries where you can say 10 years from now, if I buy into a bond as an investment, that bond will be, the promise will be maintained. So what we need to do is to use investment as leverage, so that the kind of structure that attracts money, because money is a visitor. You may take it to Ghana and say, at midnight, who can you rely upon in Ghana to fight for your rights to receive what is due to you? Do you rely on the president who is inviting you today and tomorrow is gone? Or do you rely on institutions that are established and informed by a value system that you can subscribe to? So that investment, if America says, please follow your own rules, your own constitutions, they are called, they are interfering. But there are very few African Americans who are in the business of the rule of law.
There are very few African Americans who are in the business of what?
The rule of law. We are in transactions, not in transforming Africa so that it can be home for safe and secure investments in the future. So you may invest in a bond, but poverty is what will change priorities. Because imagine, for you to be a president, you need voters. And some of the people who vote have no stake at all in what the future holds.
Yeah, I see.
So we have a big challenge in Africa. That's why we set up this 1873, so that we can begin to talk about what is required to secure investments. Without anyone calling you my sister a foreigner tomorrow, and today they say bring your money, and they call it sisterly money, and then tomorrow they say go back to America. What is ours is ours.
Yes, exactly.
So we need to move away from transactions to transformation, but use transactions as a bait for transformation. So I'd given the act to Prince to say, look at this act. Send it to your friends who are lawyers to understand what can happen in Africa. Because I'm the victim of it. So you're already a storyteller, my sister. And you can answer the question, would you put money in a country that doesn't subscribe to basic values that protect investment?
Uh-huh.
And if these people are black, would you overlook it because they are black?
No.
Or you'll be the last person like Mandela standing up for something. And then tell the president in Ghana to say, President, if this thing was a law in your country, what would be your reaction like? If he tries to explain it, then you know that's a wrong place for you to invest. If he says, not in my name, then you say, please go public. So that, China changed. Today, people put their money in China. But the Chinese did not go through a factory. They are still the same people, but different values. So Africa needs you, my sister. We need your experiences, we need your ability to think and reason. And man will always find a reward.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, my brother. I will call you in a day or so.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I just recorded the conversation so that you can hear it for yourself, and you can share it. If you need to share it, you can cut the portions that speak to you. And then from there, we know what we have to do. So thank you very much for your time, and I am downloading so that I don't have to repeat myself, so that one day these conversations will become other people's stuff to learn from. So thank you very much. So like we said, this show is about learning. It's about creating platforms for learning. And our song is Amazing Grace. So,
shout out.
Now am found, was blind.